Okay, so I've started the recording. Are the things about temp objects, R values, move constructor, move assignment, are those things clear? Things that we discussed last time. Will the marking of CS102 lab mid exam will be the code written in the class and the functions you wrote of class and not what's written in the main, right? I'm not sure you'll have to ask the TA because it was the lab instructor and the TA who made the exam and they will be checking it. So you'll have to ask them, I think. So most, okay. So, any questions regarding move constructor, move assignment? Okay, no response, so I'm assuming all's good or that you guys have not even tried at all. Could you repeat when move is used? So move is used, especially, I mean, it will be move constructor and move assignment. They will be called automatically when you either initialize an object from an R value or assign from an R value. Okay. And we know what R values are. R values are the temporaries that are created when you return from a function or during the evaluation of a function. During the evaluation of an expression. Okay, so whenever we initialize from an R value or we assign from an R value, the move version of that copy constructor or that assignment operator will be called if you have defined them. Does that answer the question? And the advantage of using move instead of copy is that move is much faster than copying. Okay, but move will steal data from the source object. Okay, so we need to, I mean, be aware of the fact that after the move, the source object will not contain the data. It will be like a shell, empty shell. Okay, it will not contain whatever resource there was, I mean, memory allocated on heap or whatever it was. It will be stolen from the temporary R value object. Does that answer the question? Okay, good. Is move constructor does div copy or shallow copy? Actually, it will take the data away. So in shallow copy, basically in deep copy, you have two separate copies. Okay. So in shallow copy, you have two pointers pointing to the same data. But here, neither of those situations happens. You don't have two separate copies and neither you have two pointers which are pointing to the same data. Okay, it's just that data will be taken from one object and it will be assigned to the other object. It's just moved from one object to the other. Okay. Okay, so if you have got the hang of most of the move thing, then today let's discuss a couple of things which, I mean, we were not able to discuss previously. So let me share my slide and screen with you guys. So are you guys able to see the terminal? Okay, good. So let's talk about initializing data inside constructors. Okay, so let me create a class. Let me see if you have any class which we can use. Like rect vertex rect contain. Rectangle point. Okay, rectangle contains point. Okay, so let's make a copy of it. Rect code cpp. Okay, so you see we have a class called point. Point basically stores x and y coordinates. Okay, a point is just a Cartesian point in xy plane. So we can basically we have two constructors. One is a default constructor, which does nothing. And the other is like a two argument constructor on line number 8, which will take two values and assign them to x and y when creating a new object respectively. So we have functions to read the value of x and y on an object, and we have functions to basically assign or set the value of x and y, and a function to show the values, and then we have basically a class rectangle with a friend of this class point, and function distance is also a friend of this class point. So we'll forget about these friends for the moment and concentrate on the class rectangle. So this class rectangle, it has two private members, member variables of type point. One is the top left corner of the rectangle, storing the coordinates for a top left corner, and the other is the bottom right corner of the rectangle. So once we create a rectangle, here we have only a non-default constructor. We don't have a default constructor for the rectangle. So this non-default constructor, it basically takes two points and initializes this top left and bottom right from those points. So there we go. So then you have a function called area, which will calculate the area of the rectangle. So are the declarations of these two classes clear? Do you have any questions, confusions about these two classes, the code that I've just shown, the declaration of class point and the declaration of class rectangle? Is this clear? Okay, no response, so I'm assuming it is clear to you guys. Okay, good. So let's go to the main. Main, we basically create two points, P1, P2. And distance function, for the moment, let's comment it. And using these two points, we create a rectangle. So for the rectangle function, these two points will be created, and the rectangle, basically object R1, it will be initialized using these two points P1 and P2. So P1 will be initializing the top left corner and P2 the bottom right corner of the rectangle, and then we call area. So what I wanted to talk about was this. If somebody's mic is on. So what I wanted to talk about was this basically initializing in the constructor. When we initialize something inside the constructor, here we are initializing, for example, on this line number 50, this two argument constructor for the rectangle will be called R1, which means it's line number 31. This rectangle constructor will be called. So rectangle is basically one constructor only. So this will be used to initialize the top left and bottom right members of this constructor. But my question is, when this rectangle object will be created, its member variables will also be created. So when are those member variables created? When will this top left and bottom right member variables be created? Inside this constructor or before this constructor? Let's say if we did this, if we did like this, just a minute, we don't have a copy, so we can do it like this. Point A is equal to, I think this should work also, because although we don't have a copy constructor for or assignment copy assignment operator for this point type, but default versions will be generated. Okay, and default version will do a member by member copy, and for point function, for point class, member by member copy is good enough for us. So my question remains, when will these member variables top left and bottom right be created? Or in other words, on line number 32 and line number 33, is this an assignment is happening or an initialization is happening? Initialization. So I think by now you guys know the difference between initialization and assignment. So what's the difference between initialization and assignment? Initialization and assignment both use this symbol, okay, and both copy values from the right side to the left side, but there is a difference between initialization and assignment. No, Talha, let's say I have this int x is equal to 5. Is this an assignment or an initialization? Okay, so your definition, the above line, that assignment copies into a new variable. So here x is a new variable, and assignment, I mean, equal to is copying the value 5 into x. So, but you're correct that this is not initialization, this is an assignment. Sorry. This is not an assignment, this is an initialization. This, I mean, your answer is correct. So what's the difference between initialization and assignment? Somebody please. Initialization is declaring and defining a variable at the same time. Okay, and what is assignment? not already declared, already defined variable. Okay, so declaration just introduces something in the program. Definition is where basically memory is assigned to that object. Okay, so if there is no memory, no memory has been assigned to that object, then we cannot basically store value in that object. So definition is the part where memory is allocated to an object. Okay, so int x, this is declaration as well as definition. Okay, int x is equal to 5, this is declaration, definition as well as initialization. Okay, and here x is equal to 77, this is assignment. Okay, so the difference between initialization and assignment is that initialization will assign the value. Initialization give variable an initial value when it's created, while assignment gives variable at point after variable. Okay, so that's the correct definition. Initialization gives a value during the creation of the variable. Okay, so in the line int x is equal to 5, we are creating x as well as assigning value to it. Okay, so this is initialization. And x is equal to 77, this is normal assignment because it is storing value in an already created object. Okay, object has been already created, its memory has already been allocated, it might have been used before this line many times, and here in this line we are assigning value to an already existing object, so this is assignment. Okay, so I hope the differences between assignment and initialization are clear to everybody. So my question was, when we create the rectangle R1 on line number 32 and line number 33, is this an assignment happening or an initialization? Okay, or in other words, at what point the member variables top left and bottom right are created? You only have two choices, either it's an assignment or an initialization. Okay, so everybody can take a guess. The probability of being wrong is only 50%, which is also equal to the probability of being right. Good, initialization. Any other guess? So by initialization, you guys mean that the variables top left and bottom right, they are being created on these same lines, line number 32 and line number 33. That's what I'm understanding from your answer. Is this correct, my understanding? When you say initialization, it means that the variables are created on these lines. Okay, good. So if these variables are created on these lines, which of the two constructors will be called for these two points, top left and bottom right? We see in this point class, we have two constructors. This default one and this is which takes a two argument constructor, or two argument constructor can't be called. So we can have a copy constructor. Let's have a copy constructor. Okay. So which of these three constructors will be called for top left and bottom right on line number 33 and line number 34? Let us put printfs here. Okay, copy constructor is called. Okay, copy constructor will be called. So let's run this program and see what happens. So in main we are creating P1, P2. So for P1, P2, the second constructor will be called. Okay, and then when R1 will be created, top left and bottom right, we'll see which constructor is getting called for top left and bottom right. So there we go. Oops. Point const p. Const p reference. Okay, it should be reference. Should be reference to const point. Okay, yeah. So now let's brace ourselves and run this. So you see, here this is called, the second constructor is called this, I mean the first two lines, they are for P1 and P2. Okay, so let me open this. Okay. So line number 46, P1 and P2 will be created. So second constructor is being called for P1 and P2. Okay, so this one is good. Then there are two copy constructors called. So why are there two copy constructors being called and why are two default constructors being called? So let's start with the copy constructor. Why do you think there are these two copy constructors being called? Where are these two copy constructors being called? Which lines will trigger inside this code? Which lines will trigger the call to these copy constructors? Okay, if for 33 and 44, then when will those default constructors be called? Which lines will basically trigger the call to default constructor? No, P1 and P2, the second constructor is being called for P1 and P2. Okay, so line number, I mean the first two line, printed lines, second constructor, this one is for P1 and P2. Okay, because P1 and P2 are both created using two arguments. Okay, so for two argument constructor, we have called it the second constructor. So for P1 and P2, second constructor is being called. Where is, I mean, where are these two extra lines coming from? When will copy constructor be called and when will default constructor be called? Somebody, I mean, does anybody who know the answer? In line number 32. We'll come to default constructor later, but first start with copy constructor. Where do you guys think these copy constructors are being called? Default are coming after that, so we'll come to default later. Are there any copies being created when we create R1? Yeah, so what is 49? Yeah, 49 we are creating R1, but which line will create the make the call to copy constructor? 33, no. Before we reach line number 33, are there any objects of type point being created before we reach line number 33? What's 29, 30? No, for copy constructors, it's not line number 29, 30. Copy constructors 32. Very good. Okay, 32. No, default constructor will come later. For copy constructor is line number 32. Why? Because when we call this constructor, when we create R1, this constructor will be called, and the arguments A and B will be created. Okay, so the arguments A and B will be created, and the arguments A and B, they will be created. From P1 and P2, so therefore they will call copy constructors. Okay, so copy constructors are being called by line number 32 for the creation of objects A and B. Is it clear to everybody? Okay, so I hope it's clear to others also that arguments, when we pass objects by arguments, by value, for the local arguments, copy constructors are called because local copies are made. So A and B are local copies of P1 and P2. So therefore, for A and B, copy constructors are being called. Okay. If that's settled, then let's come to default constructors. So, I mean, since the only objects that are created after that are like top left and bottom right, so most probably default constructors are being called for top left and bottom right. So why are default constructors being called for top left and bottom right? Because apparently on line number 33 and 44, top left and bottom right, they use A and B. So the only justification can be that this line number 33 and 34, this is not an initialization, but rather an assignment. So top left and bottom right, they are created before we arrive at line number 33. And on line number 33, we have an assignment operation going on and not an initialization operation. Okay. So on line number 33, 34, no object is being created, okay, but rather the values of A and B are being assigned to already created member variables top left and bottom right. Okay, is this clear? That line number 33, 34, they are being assigned, not initialized. Is it clear? We'll come to the question when they are created after this, but for the moment, just to emphasize that line number 33 and 34, they are doing assignments and not initialization. Okay. So they are created somewhere before line number 33 and 34. Okay. So, but what if we wanted to initialize our objects with A and B, not assign to them after creation? So how can we do that? So C++ basically provides you a method of initializing the object member variables when creating the object. So the syntax is something like this. So after this parenthesis, you basically put a colon, and then you can do top left, and then you can pass a value from which you want to initialize this top left object. So that value is passed inside brackets. So brackets, we can be round bracket and parenthesis as well as curly brackets. Okay, so I'm doing curly brackets. There is a slight difference which you will learn on your own later. But okay, so this is B and that one was A. So this is, okay. So here, this syntax tells your compiler or whatever to initialize top left and bottom right from A and B respectively. Okay. Now we don't need this thing because this was not an initialization anyway, it was an assignment. And since now we know a better method to initialize, so we don't need this assignment. Okay, so this is the syntax after this closing this parenthesis. In the function definition, you do put a colon and then you can initialize those member variables of this class separated by a comma. So now let's basically save this and let's see what happens now. Let's go back to. Now you see the first two lines are for P1 and P2. The second two lines are for the local objects A and B being created. And the third two lines are basically for top left and bottom right. And this time a copy constructor is being called. Okay, so this is another syntax of initializing member variables rather than assigning them. Okay, so inside the body of the constructor function, we are assigning them. Okay, so by the time we enter the body, those variables have already been created. Okay, we are just assigning them. And they are created right just before the body of the constructor. So we have a chance to initialize them during creation using this syntax. Is it clear? Initializing member variables inside the body of the constructor, basically its assignment. So to initialize them during creation, we will have to use this syntax. Hello. Can you guys hear me? Is it clear? The syntax to initialize member variables. Okay, good. So I hope it's clear to others also. Okay. So this is done. This is something that I wanted to introduce at the very beginning, but did not get time. So now that this is done. Okay, so by the way, we could have like, when I initially wrote this program, here, for example, if I had the old thing, and if I had commented this function, this one, default constructor, what will happen now? Now the default constructor for class point is commented, and you can basically, here we are initializing top left and bottom right, assigning top left and bottom right inside the body of the function. So what will happen to my program now when I compile it? You guys guess, and I will this. Okay, so you see, it's telling you on line number 33, no matching call for point. Okay, it is unable to find this default constructor for point. Okay, and that is because before this line on line number 33, it is trying to create, before entering the body of the function, it is trying to create top left and bottom right. And since we are not initializing them with anything, it is trying to create top left and bottom right using default constructor. And since the default constructor has been commented, it does not exist, the compiler gives you error that it will not be able to create top left and bottom right because no matching constructor, which means no default constructor for the class point exists. Okay. So here, if we had like this one, here we will not be creating top left and bottom right using default constructor, but rather copy constructor. So now, even without default constructor, our thing should work. Okay, now let's just compile and start. Okay, so I hope this is clear how you can initialize member variables in C++. Okay. And if that's clear, let's move to another topic. There's another thing that you guys have been using. So Let's say if I want to create a class my complex. Why did I name my another class my complex? Okay, let's say class complex. And real. So I have declared a class called complex. Did you notice anything about this class that I've declared? Let me compile it for you and maybe that will give you a hint. So once we declare this class, if I declare a number object of this class here. Okay, so this operator is not defined for complex, which is game pulse. We have not declared it, but so let's go there. So let's give it a third argument, third variable, and then so let's initialize them instead of now that we don't know the syntax. Real zero, imaginary zero. And then we don't need anything inside the body. So this is good. Conditional. It is in. I think we saved it, right? Let me. Okay, let's. I couldn't see. So this example is not working. I don't know. let's see. We try to go to the first pair. No branch for a pair plus 12 complex and complex. I don't know what it's called. It's called. Let me. Give me a minute. Again, it's a plus operator that's not defined for complex. That is correct, but just so what if we try to define this outside main? Okay, simply declare and compress complex. Okay, I am unable to produce what I was trying to produce. So let's abandon that and let me see if you guys have any comments. No comments. Okay. So let's do this. Let's say I want to define another class point. But this time I want it to be 3D. So what can happen is first of all, let's load this complex. You see the first error, it is saying redefinition of class point. The thing is, we in C++ there is again another rule which is called one definition rule. Okay. That means a thing can be defined only once in C++. So this one definition rule applies to classes also. So classes, sorry, you cannot have two definitions for a class with the same name. Okay. So we already have a class called point, which is a 2D point. Now I wanted to declare another class point. I want to call it point as well, but this time I want to make it a 3D point. Okay. So what happens is, since both things are called point, they have the same identifier, so there's name clash. Okay, so there's name clash, and the compiler basically is telling you that you already defined point once, and now you are redefining point. Okay, so the previous definition was here in this line. So sometimes it may happen that different people have written code, and when we combine that code, what can happen is that they might have given similar names to different functionalities, okay, to objects with different functionalities. Similar names for classes with different functionalities. So in this case, there will be a name clash. Okay. So how can we resolve such a name clash with minimum fuss, without going through all the code and changing all the similar names? So one idea is that names are clash within a certain scope. Okay. So if we limit names to a certain scope, and if the same name exists in different scopes, then that name will not clash. Okay, just like you can have a variable x in main and a variable x in function f1. Okay, so it's the same name variable, but the name exists in different scopes. So as long as the same name is not within the same scope, there will not be a name clash. Is this understandable explanation? Okay, so how can we basically limit the scope of certain things, limit the definitions to a certain scope? So one is that there are natural occurring scopes in C++. There is the global scope, which basically, is accessible from anywhere. Then you have the local scope within a function. Okay, so variables declared within the function remain valid only for the scope of that function. And similarly, scopes between curly brackets for loop, if, else, etc. Then you have another scope, which is a class level scope. Okay, so once you have defined a variable inside a class, it is limited to, its scope is limited to within the scope of that class. Okay, so if we declare a variable x inside a class, and if we declare a variable x outside that class, then these two variables exist in two different scopes. Okay, so the variable x which is inside the class, it will not clash with the variable x that is outside the class. So again, there are two different scopes. So class is another scoping mechanism that you can limit the scope of the member variables of the class within the scope of that class. Okay, so they will not affect outside names. Okay. Another scoping mechanism is what in C++ is termed as a namespace. Okay. So a namespace is basically another scoping mechanism that you can define things within a namespace. And things define, so namespace also works like a scoping mechanism, and things defined in different namespaces will not clash with each other, even if they have same names. So right now I have two classes that I want to define with a name point. One is 2D and one is 3D. So what I can do is I can define them in different namespaces. Okay, so let us see how we can define a namespace. So I go there, and here this is a class that I'm defining, and I want to define this class in a separate namespace. So the syntax for defining a namespace is, you basically do namespace, this is a keyword, and then you can give names to namespaces, just like you can give names to classes. So for this namespace, we can give it a name, let's call it 3D. And then inside this, we can define this class. And then we can close the namespace. So I'm not sure whether there's a comma after namespace closing or not. Let's see. Okay. Expect identifier before numeric constant. Okay, so we can't start a variable name with a number. Okay. We can have number inside a variable name, but not start it with number. Okay, this compile. So now this class point, it's a 3D point, it's inside a namespace. Therefore, and this other class point, the 2D point, it is inside the global namespace. So now these two namespaces are not clashing with each other. Okay, so these two classes with the same name point, they exist in two different namespaces. So they exist in two different scopes. So therefore, they are not clashing with each other. So what we can do is we can basically, let's define, okay, the So let's give it a function. So now in my class, when I do point p1 and p2, these are basically the objects of class point, which is in the global namespace. But if I want to use the 3D class point for that I'll have to access it within that namespace. Okay, so to access something within namespace, this is the syntax. We have to use this again scope resolution operator that you already know, point p3. Okay. And here you can do p3.show. So let's comment these lines. Oops. Oh, it's a colon. Should be a semicolon. So there it is. point. Okay, so let's go to the first error. And 3D main. So the namespace 3D, it ends here. Point and name class point. So there is some bracket missing. Let me see if this is necessary. Okay, so we have not put a bracket here. Okay. Okay, so we have put the bracket in the wrong place. Things are not going well today. Okay. Okay, so this is P1 and P2 created, and then we have this show function for class P3, object P3 of type 3D point. Okay. So these two points exist in different namespaces. So we can basically restrict the scope of our certain definitions to namespaces. That way, people, when they write code, they can restrict their code to namespaces, and when they combine, they can combine their code and there will be no name clashes because everything will be contained in its proper namespace or its proper scope. Okay, so the question is, do you have to use the scope resolution operator every time we use access point? That depends. You can either use it like this, or you can use it like this, for example. But the thing is, you can do like this, but that will create problem. What you can do is, you can here, you can using 3D point. Okay. So what it will do is it will basically introduce this class point inside this main. But this will cause again the name clash, because there already exists a class called point inside this main, which is basically the global point. So this will cause a name clash. But otherwise, if we had used like this using thing, then you did not need to use the scope resolution operator every time you access point. So let's see first with the name clash, and then let's change it to access directly. So this will cause a name clash, because now in main two points are accessible, one from the 3D and one from the global namespace. You see, the class point is class point. Yeah, because this point, now it is stating this point as for P1, P2 also, it is stating this point as 3D point. Okay, because we have brought in the point from 3D namespace into main. So this point is also considered a 3D point, and 3D point does not have a constructor that takes two arguments. Okay, so this is again an error. So what we can do is we can change the name of this class just to show the use of this using thing. We can basically change name to point, and then once we have included this point here, then we don't need to do this point every time. We can basically do like this, because now this line number 55 has introduced the point class from namespace into main, and after this thing, this point class PT is accessible without using the scope resolution operator. So here it is. Okay, so the two classes are different. For the moment, their name is different, but this was just to show you the use of this using keyword. So either you can import things from a certain namespace one by one, or let's say if there are a lot of things that you want to include from this namespace, let's say it has like 20 classes, and you want to import all of them into your namespace, what you can do is you can call, instead of importing them one by one, you can just directly import the whole namespace. Okay. So using, in this case, it will be like this, using namespace 3D. Okay, so this will basically bring in all the types and names from the namespace 3D in your main. Okay, so again, this will include point PT, and this will also be accessible. Okay, so this namespaces are basically used to create separate scopes for different names which risk clashing. Yes, so now you guys know that this line number 3, what does this mean, using namespace mean? Okay, so C++, its standard library, it has also created a namespace for its standard library, which is called std, and it's pronounced, I think it's pronounced std. So std namespace is the namespace that contains all the names for C++ library. Okay, so standard library. So standard library contains all these classes like cout, cin, all these objects, and all the other stuff. So either you can import all of that stuff in your program using this namespace std, or you can access them directly like you can use access them directly. stdcout, and similarly you have to copy it everywhere. Okay, so endl is also part of, endl again is part of std. So now I'm accessing cout directly using the scope resolution operator. So the question was, is importing all of the names of std in your program, is it a good practice or bad practice? So that depends whether you think including all these names in your global namespace, it will cause problems or not. So it might be that you wanted to name things the same way as they are named in standard library. If that is the case, then of course importing everything from standard namespace, it will pollute your namespace and it will cause name clashes with your classes or objects, and you will have to change the names of classes. In that case, you should basically selectively import things from namespace. So to answer your questions, but the importing everything is that it's like the ease of use. You don't have to write std colon colon every time. So generally it is considered not a very good practice to include everything. And I mean, all the standard library has like hundreds of or thousands of names. So you don't know what thing can cause a clash. So generally it is considered not a very good practice to import everything from std in your global namespace. But for the moment, like since you are students, you guys can basically import things because, I mean, for the ease of use. Otherwise, the standard practice should be that you should import things selectively. Okay. Okay, so this was an introduction to namespaces, and since, I mean, you guys have been seeing this thing from the beginning, for the very first program, this using namespace std, and I don't know whether you guys had explored on your own what a namespace is, but this was just to, so that now you guys know everything that you write in your code, you should know what every line is doing in your code, okay? So this was the line that was not explained in the class until now. So that's also done. So that's it for today. Any questions regarding namespaces? No? Okay. So I'll stop the recording. Let me download your attendance.